Alrighty, good morning everyone. It is 11 o'clock and I am back to do yet another stream. So if you're new here, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. We stream every weekday at 11 o'clock a.m. and we're bringing you experiments, activities that you can do at home, and we have a chat function there. So please feel free to interact in the chat, say hi and ask any questions. And today, we're actually joined by a really, really special guest. It's not always that we get an expert in their field. And today, we have a civil engineer. And his name is Danilo. And he's going to come talk to us about civil engineering. So again, if you have any questions, leave it in the chat. And we'll see if we can get some answers. Okay? So, I want to say hi to Danilo. And please give Danilo a warm Geering Up Live welcome for today.
Hello everyone, my name is Danilo and I'm a recent grad of civil engineering at UBC, and I live here on campus in family housing, so that's on Musqueam territory. They're traditional, ancestral and unceded territory. I'm really excited to be here and I can't wait to share some of my some of the civil engineering with you.
Okay, so Danilo is here. He's a civil engineer. And what we're gonna talk about are kind of centered around these three main questions, okay? And if you're just joining us, you didn't miss anything. We're just getting started right now. So we're gonna talk about what is underneath us, right? Not all of us get a chance to look at what's underneath us, but Danilo does. So he'll tell us more about that. And what is the strategy for a design of, you know, what's below the surface? And also, how can we participate in civil engineering? You know, if we don't have tools like jackhammers and things like that, how can we participate in civil engineering? I'm so excited to bring you this episode today. So, Danilo, my first question to you is, what is civil engineering and how is that different from other types of scientists and engineers?
Well, a civil engineer is mostly interested in the built environment, and that would include the operation, the construction and the maintenance of some of these infrastructure that you see every day. And that's roads and bridges, highways and pipelines, all sorts of things like that. That differs from other engineers who might be more concerned with devices, electronics, software. Those are just some examples. There are many different fields of engineering. Civil engineering is more around what you would see in the city that around you.
Awesome. That's so cool. So our first question, remember, that we're going to ask today is, what's below the surface? And Danilo, I've actually never been to any sort of underground, like waterworks or pipes or anything like that. I kind of have a rough idea, like the picture to my right here. So Danilo, can you tell me more about what's actually underneath the surface?
Well, there are a lot of things that make a city work. And some of the things you see, of course, you're walking down sidewalks and you see the buildings around you and you get on a SkyTrain and right, it takes you somewhere. But there's a lot also hidden. And some of those things you use every day and you may not truly appreciate, or you may not even know they're there. And like some of these things would include how the electricity arrives at the plug that powers your laptop, and also quite simply turning on a water tap. Mm-hmm. Where your garbage goes. All these different things are not always seen, but definitely you notice it when it doesn't work.
Yeah, now that you mention it, there are a lot of things that kind of run through our houses that we don't really appreciate or realize, like electricity coming to us, and also like my stove uses like an open flame, so natural gas as well. And also, like you said, like even brushing my teeth and, you know, turning on the tap for my shower, or, you know, using the toilet and everything like that all runs through pipes underground. So that brings me to my next question. So why do we actually put these systems underground? Why not just hang them overhead like maybe we used to, like telephone lines?
There's a lot of reasons that we sometimes put some of our utilities underground. And some of, like you said, some of the older infrastructure is overhead, and a lot of new developments put everything underground for protection and from collisions, if you're talking about telephone poles and stuff like that. Some of it's aesthetics because it looks nicer, but some really practical reasons include, you know, just to keep it out of the way. Mm-hmm. Also, water lines freeze. So there's some benefits that go along with burying it. Now, there are some bad things too, of course, because when something goes wrong, you got to dig it up. But having said that, there's so much going on under the ground, you wouldn't want that laying on the surface, because then where would we walk and drive, and where would we build our structures?
That actually makes a lot of sense. And I think for my neighborhood, there's actually no power lines or telephone lines above head. So I'm assuming, like you said, they're all underground at this point. So that's really, really cool. I never really noticed that until, you know, we got to talking. And can you give us an example of a system that runs underground that maybe you have worked on or you're interested in, and you can tell us a little bit more about that? Maybe do you have an example?
A system that I find very fascinating is that of wastewater, and we also call it the sewer system, basically, is what most people would refer to it as. And it's a great example of a municipal engineering system that people don't put much thought into, and really, when it doesn't work, it's usually a disaster. Now, it's also very interesting from a civil engineer's perspective, because it's one of our greatest contributions to the health and well-being of society in general. Right. Moving our waste safely and keeping it away from our drinking water has had a profound improvement on our health and well-being. And that's something that civil engineers are very proud of, our legacy in that respect. Now, the storm sewers, like the water runoff from streets, flows up with gravity in partially filled pipes. And this is efficient in that we don't have to pump the water everywhere, but it also poses problems. And it poses challenges in terms of how do we facilitate that water to flow where we want it to go.
I see. So, sorry to cut you off. So I was just thinking, like you said, yeah, like when I went camping and there was no sort of safe way to get the waste, you know, out from the outhouses and things like that, I guess, yeah, it's really unpleasant. I never thought about it. So thank you so much for civil engineers and their work for providing us with, you know, clean and safe water and be able to get rid of the waste. So Vancouver has a lot of mountains and hills, right? My question is, you mentioned that usually waste flows with gravity. So you mentioned that water, you know, waste systems flow downwards and gravity carries the waste out. So Vancouver has a lot of hills. How do, you know, engineers work around that? How do engineers work around having the wastewater go maybe over or through the hills?
That's a great question, Sam. And as much as we would love it if everyone's waste just flowed all the way down, of course we have hills in our cities, and we have to bump up that liquid over top of those hills, and we use pumps for that. So we call it a lift station. So we would take advantage of the flow going down until it reaches a point where it won't flow. And we lift, essentially we pump it up over a hill, thus allowing it to continue flowing to where it's eventually gonna go, the water treatment plant.
I see. So these things that we see on the ground are kind of like lift stations that are underground of it, and then they use pumps to lift that up. That's super cool. So now we're gonna move on to our activity of the day. So like I said before, you know, a lot of us can't, you know, tear up the ground or have a look underneath manholes because that's so unsafe. We've come up with an activity. Danilo and I have come up with an activity to help you understand what's beneath the surface. So actually, if you take a look at the pictures on my right and underneath me, that is an underground sort of system that Danilo has made. and all they're using is cardboard boxes and toilet paper rolls and paper towel rolls to make sort of tubes and then label them and put them in different layers. And Danilo's gonna talk more about this awesome activity that you can do at home as well. But first, remember, before any sort of activity, we always have to do a safety check, right? Always have to do a safety check. And this time I'm gonna let Danilo do the safety check. So can you tell us, and you're joined by a guest, I see. Can you tell us sort of what safety requirements there are in this experiment?
This was a team effort, and you may need someone to help you with this when it comes to cutting. And we used a glue gun, tape, cardboard. That's about it, right? We have some shish kebab skewers.
Cool.
The gas lines are shish kebab. Doweling. I'm not sure where we got it, but that's doweling. You're just using stuff from around the house. Get creative. Anything that kind of creates a tube or roll up a piece of paper.
I see.
Everything's fair game.
Nice. And I see you brought a special guest next to you there. Do you mind introducing us and then also talking more about your underground model?
Well, this is my daughter, Cicada.
Hi.
And we came up with an idea to explore and to kind of put our minds in an engineer's brain, kind of, if that makes any sense. But we're going to explore beneath the surface of the street. Just as Sam said, we're going to peel back the asphalt and look what's down there. So there's a few things. We have stormwater systems. We have the sanitary, like, sewer systems. We also have fresh water. We have natural gas. We also have, in some cases, cities run electricity underneath. And we also have, those are the four things we're going to do today, is the fresh water, the sanitary, the storm water, and the natural gas. So we're gonna ask you to get a box and some paper and some pipes. We use some toilet paper rolls and some paper towel rolls and some paper, and create a diorama that represents these types of pipes, keeping in mind some of the important things that make the water and other fluids flow. So this is an example of what we've made. I'm going to bring it right in close here so you can see.
That's awesome.
This right here is a sidewalk.
Okay.
Beside this house. And we have some other things here that Cicada's going to help identify. So what are some of the things, Cicada? You take it away. Show us some of the important features.
This is a storm water drain. And this is a manhole because there's a turn. This is the main waterway where the water will hook up to that house. This is a little pipe connected to the catch basin that leads down to the stormwater drain.
Awesome.
This is the sewer, and this is the gas in the gas conductor.
The gas actually hooks up kind of like your house does. Did you notice that? The gas line usually pops up on the side of your house and it goes in the side wall. If you go outside, if you have a house or your neighbor has a house, you'll probably see it like that. So there's a lot of stuff going on in here. I'm gonna hold it so it's level. This is if you were lying on your stomach on the street, you would see a manhole cover, and the sidewalk here. So these are all level, but what you look, you're gonna see that there's different layers of pipes.
Right.
And that's because there's a lot going on underneath the ground, and we can't just put them all in the same line. And if I were to hold it like this, you would see that when you open it up and you dig away all the dirt, there's a lot going on under the roads.
Awesome. Danilo, thanks for sharing with that. Yeah, so this is an activity that all of you viewers can do at home with a parent to help you glue gun or cut things, and you can just use things around the house to make pipes and tubes, and you just need a cardboard box, you know, any sort of Amazon box would work fine, and you can sort of design your own underground system for your city. For the people that are out there that want to try to design this, Danilo, how did you design the waste system to flow? Did you have any sort of pipes in there that you're thinking about, or are you just going to use gravity?
This brings us back to this idea of sewer sewer and storm water running in partially filled pipes and using gravity. So let's look at the sewer line. You'll see that it comes out of the house here and it flows down on a pretty steep angle and it connects to the sewer line right there. And if you look at this, we were very careful to put a small slope in the actual sewer line as it runs down. Now, of course, you can't put much slope, and it doesn't need much slope, but you can imagine the problems if you got it wrong. It would just back up, and then it would want to creep up into the manhole, and we don't want to smell that, and we don't want it leaking out onto the streets.
I see. So I want to point out a couple of things that Danilo has done in his model that are also done out there in the real world. So like he said about the stormwater or the waste system, these pipes actually have a downward slope. Not a lot, but just a little bit of a downward slope so that gravity can actually carry the water inside it, you know, to where it needs to go. So you actually use less energy because you don't need a pump or anything like that. So the downward slope is a great thing to consider. And also, if you look at the picture, Danilo has made manholes. So manholes are places in the large pipes that actually turn. So that is super, super cool. So if you're gonna give this a try at home, I highly recommend, you know, working with someone and you can sort of plan out the city. And also, if you notice, they had different pipes at different heights. So in real life, it's just like that. There was a question that came in that said, how far down are pipes? So actually, pipes can vary depending on the type of pipes. There's sewer lines that can be as shallow as like maybe a couple feet to as deep as like 6 feet underneath us. So depending on the system, whether it's electricity, natural gas, you know, internet, stormwater, waste, or freshwater, all of these pipes are in sort of different levels underground. And this is all taken into account of in civil engineering. And Danilo, I have a question for you. So when you're designing that, you know, underground system, seems like there's a lot to think about. There's a lot to design, right? So is there a strategy that you use that you find helpful to be able to sort of design this big project? So kind of like, what was your design strategy, and do engineers actually have a specific design cycle? Do engineers use some sort of like framework?
Well, I'm gonna quickly explain kind of an engineer's thought process when they approach any kind of problem. Right. And we call it a design cycle, but I'm pretty sure that you've applied this without all the fancy terms. Mm-hmm. You know, any kind of anything that you're trying to solve, you generally look at what is the problem you're trying to solve. You know, what do you have to do to make it work, whatever solution you're looking at doing. You're maybe gonna draw out some sketches, you're gonna make a plan, and then before you make it, you're probably gonna wanna test to see, like, you know, think about, is this the best solution?
I see.
So you might change your plan, and that's called iteration, where you go back and forth a couple times until you're happy with it, and then you have to build it. So these are the kinds of things we did, and what are some of the things we learned? Gluing some of the things was hard, so we decided, let's tape it because it's easier. Mm-hmm. So these are some of the things you really just have to start the project to learn, and some of the things you can plan ahead.
Yeah.
Right. Nice. Awesome. Yeah, so the engineering design cycle is kind of like a framework that all engineers and scientists sort of use to solve problems, right? You identify the problem, you have an idea, you execute that idea, and then you go back to see if there's anything else you need to fix or change up. So that's awesome. And Megumi has a really related question. When we were talking about slopes in the pipes, why use a slight slope instead of a steeper slope? Well, Megumi, I'm not a civil engineer, but my guess as to why we use a slight slope and not a steeper one is because if you have a very steep slope and you need a pipe flowing from one area to another area, then that means that you're going to be basically going deeper in a shorter amount of space. And sometimes we can't go that deep, right? We want a slight slope enough so that gravity can affect the water to flow, but not so much that, you know, it's gonna go straight underground. That's my guess about it. We can give that question to Danilo to answer in the future, perhaps. But we'll move on by having a question. I have a question for Danilo. So, you know, when we're living in Vancouver, we're super, super lucky and blessed and fortunate to be able to have fresh drinking water out of our taps, right? Most of us that are watching in Vancouver, we turn on the taps and we can drink straight from it. We have water fountains everywhere. We have a lot of clean water in Vancouver. But when I think about this, I'm also thinking about, well, do other people also have the same privileges that we do? Does everyone in BC or in Canada have the same privileges that we do?
Unfortunately not, Sam. There's many factors that play into operating and even just acquiring a water treatment facility. And this is a real challenge for small communities and remote communities. And there's a lot of reasons why water quality isn't good enough to drink. But this is certainly something that engineers deal with all the time. And some of the challenges include, you know, just resources to actually build it. And it can be costly to maintain. And some of our remote indigenous communities struggle with this. And consequently, we can't say that all of us have the same access to safe quality water. And it's a human right. It's something that the Canada's Constitution Act affirms. And, you know, this is something that we are working at as a society, but clearly it's not happening fast enough if you're the person who has to boil water or in some cases can't use it for anything. So these are social equity questions that are not isolated to engineers. It's everybody's responsibility to ensure that a community whose voice isn't heard has support, and we make it a priority, because it's only when we speak up as a unified voice that we can make sure that people have, you know, healthy water to drink and to bathe in, and it's really important.
Yeah, I like how you mentioned about, you know, when we're learning about science and engineering, it's not just about science and engineering, right? That we can also apply this in a sense of social equity, right? What are we using our science for? What are we using engineering for? And as you, if you were able to see just now, as Danilo was talking, there was a map underneath of Canada, and that map marked the amount of communities that are having water advisories, which means that their water from the tap is not clean enough to drink, right? So us as scientists and us as, you know, future scientists like you, you know, I want to put these thoughts in your head, right? Like, what do you want to use your science for? And there's people out there within our own country, within our own province, right, that are struggling with these needs that we would be able to help out with, you know, our expertise in science. So because of that, I want to show you a really, really interesting video from Global News, and it's going to talk about, you know, First Nations communities that perhaps don't have access to clean water like we do here in Vancouver. Okay, so please listen carefully. This is a really important video that talks about, like, social equity and the role that water plays in their community. So let's just give this a listen.
We literally get our identities from our land. So we have more than a passing need for water. It's a spiritual, cultural relationship that has been interfered with. If the water's doing not well, human beings are gonna reflect that.
It's something we take for granted in Canada, access to fresh drinking water at the turn of a tap. But believe it or not, there are some communities in our country that are still without it.
Trudeau promised to eliminate boil water advisories on First Nations reserves within 5 years.
By now, you've probably heard of the story of how many First Nations communities across Canada do not have access to safe drinking water. But what you might not know is how this became a reality for so many people living on reserves, and why, after years of efforts and billions of dollars in government spending, people still do not have clean water running from their taps.
So, I don't have enough time to show you all of that video, but I highly recommend going on YouTube and searching up global news, and then that title there, Why First Nations Communities Aren't Able to Get Clean Water. And you can learn a lot from that video. I highly, highly recommend you to go check it out. And yeah, Fiona, it is a really sad thing that's happening in our country right now. I mean, there's a lot of tragedies going on, but you know, this has been something that has, you know, people have always been struggling with, especially in rural communities. So please give that video a watch, you know, educate yourselves and learn more. And also, since Danilo, you're here, I want to ask, right, knowing what we just learned from the video, and we don't all have civil engineering degrees and things like that, so what can we do to help? Like, what can we as viewers and students and kids, like, what can we do to help?
You know, as people living in Vancouver, you know, we very seldom have to boil our water. So it's something that may not be on the tops of people's minds. And as a younger person, you can't vote yet, but that doesn't mean that you can't have these conversations, you know, with your parents and with your family, because it's very easy for us living in Vancouver. We have everything at our fingertips to not put the thought into what life is like for people living in communities that are more remote. And this extends to not just water, of course. You know, this could be internet access. This could be reliable electricity. So that's a great question, Sam. And it's something we all can continue to promote and discuss with the people we love and spend time with.
Awesome. So I love what you said, Danilo. So even though, you know, we aren't engineers right now, but, you know, we can use our ability to learn more and, you know, watch videos and read news articles like that, and then talk about these issues, these social issues, with our family and friends, and let them know too as well. Because like you said, raising awareness is half the battle. It's really, really useful for us to kind of spread this information. So yeah, if you're watching at home and you want to learn more, you know, look up the news articles, read them with your parents, talk about it with your parents. That would be a really, really great place to start. So thank you so much, Danilo, for teaching us that. So before you go, Danilo, I just want to summarize what we learned today. And this is where we go, ready, set, recap. And the first thing we learned is there's a lot of unseen systems under the surface. So even though we see a lot of, you know, big bridges and buildings and skyscrapers, you know, what keeps our city running, a majority of it is underground. So there's the waste system, natural gas, electricity, and even fiber optics and internet is starting to run underground now. And also, we also learned that the engineering design cycle can help us create systems that really work. So engineering design cycle, meaning you have an idea and then you execute that idea and then you go back and try to fix any problems and you go back to brainstorming. So that whole cycle is something that engineers use all the time and that we can learn to apply not just in science but also in our sort of everyday problem solving. And finally, the most important thing I think that we learned is that, you know, we can educate ourselves and the people around us on the communities, even in just in Canada, that aren't as privileged as Vancouver to receive clean water. And because of that, when we educate ourselves and we talk to more people about this, you know, we can advocate for change. And soon enough, you can vote, right? So you can have a voice and you can be able to affect these small communities, rural communities, and how they get their water. So that's really awesome. I loved that I can share this with everyone out there and just to raise a bit of social awareness. So thank you so much, Danilo, for coming by. It's been really a great pleasure. We don't get to talk about civil engineering too often, so having you by is so, so awesome. And yeah, is there anything else you wanted to say, Danilo?
Thank you, everyone, for having me. I really enjoyed sharing a little slice of civil engineering with you. And have a great day.
Cool. Awesome. So that's our episode for today. I'm going to go through the comments now to answer any questions we have. But thank you so much. If you have any sort of online classes you have to go to, by all means, I'm going to hang around here for about 5 more minutes, okay? And yeah, everyone, let's thank Danilo for coming by and helping us with our episode. There was a question that came in that said, do civil engineers work with mining companies? I think this is a question by Megumi, to make sure they don't pollute local water sources or other big companies like chemical companies. Yeah, definitely. So civil engineers will work really closely, especially with local like chemical companies, to make sure that their waste is going where it needs to go. So their waste is not going into like the river where there's gonna be fish hatching or any sort of marine animal there as well. And even for mining companies, even if they're further away from town, right, they also have a lot of waste that's produced and disrupts the environment. So yeah, civil engineers are always working together with these companies to kind of oversee the construction. And they also work with a lot of environmental scientists, right, to help sort of reduce the impact of mining and deforestation and things like that. So I want to answer some questions. I love your questions, actually. So a lot of people are wondering, Fiona's wondering, like, why is this happening? Why are these indigenous communities or rural communities not able to get fresh water? So it's not a very easy question to answer. This question is very multifaceted. So it's caused by a lot of different things. And you know, one of those things is government funding, right? And proper government funding. You know, if we're just giving these communities free water, like Saket suggests, if we're just giving, free bottled water, jugs of water, right? That's a lot of, unsustainable processes, because you're just giving them water, but you're not actually benefiting their city to sort of thrive in their conditions, right? So maybe a way that we can improve that is to perhaps build water treatment plants there, have better piping underground, and actually be able to train and provide, provide training and schooling for the people that are living in those communities that want to be able to provide the communities with water. That's a really, really great option, so that they can have engineers in their cities that are working there all the time in order to get, water for them as well. So there's a lot of, different things to talk about, especially with this topic. I highly recommend you to read up on it. And again, this is happening in our own backyard. This is happening right in British Columbia, right here. So it's a problem that, we should start learning more about as well. So great question. Awesome. So I think that's about it. Yeah, I think that's about all the questions we have today. Before you go, make sure to hit the like button there, and then give us a follow on Instagram and subscribe to our channel. So thank you everyone for coming by. I really had a great time. And if you stuck around long enough, I will show you Sam Jr. right here. There you go. Okay. Thank you everyone. Have a good day. Bye-bye.